All right, joining us now is Senator Francis Tolentino. Senator, good afternoon to you, and thank you for joining us today. Welcome to the program.
Good afternoon, Carmina. Good afternoon to your viewers as well.
I know that you're joining us as you just you've just come down from the mountains of Davao del Norte. You just joined the Manobo tribe there. We're going to talk about that later. But first, this issue of updating the Philippine map. We do know that the National Security Council is also working on an update, and theirs is going to be based on the arbitral win and UNCLOS. With the maritime zones that you are proposing, that measure they're proposing at the Senate, how different will this be, or will the two end up complementing each other, forming one general map, Senator?
No, there is only one map that will be coming up out from the Philippine Congress, and that's our version. And any other map would probably be should probably be consistent with what we will be producing. So the National Security Council probably will be supportive of our efforts, because UNCLOS, in UNCLOS, it is stated there that there should be domestic, there can be a domestic legislation, and legislation comes from the Congress.
Mm-hmm. All right. Now, how much of a game changer will this be? You kind of talked about that in the report that we ran a few seconds before we got you on air. Talk to us about the importance of this updated map now that it's going to be part of our arsenal in defending our waters. Go ahead, Senator.
It is one of the criticisms being hurled upon us by China. China's been saying you don't even have a maritime zone law. So under UNCLOS, which has been ratified decades ago, UNCLOS came out 92, 94, mm-hmm. Now 2023, we still don't have a maritime zone law, unlike 132 plus countries. Mm-hmm. They have maritime zone law. So this would delineate where our territorial sea is, continental shelf, including the exclusive economic zone. Mm-hmm. And once crafted and made into law, this will, you made the right word, arsenal, this will be part of our part of our arguments that China should abide by UNCLOS, because the progeny of UNCLOS is the maritime zone law that we are crafting right now. So this will fortify our claims.
And do you think, Senator, that this will also help move forward the discussions on a code of conduct in the waters?
Yeah, definitely, because other nations like Indonesia, they have a maritime zone law. The same is true with I think Vietnam and Malaysia. They have their own maritime zone law. So this is a process. As I have said yesterday, we might take 4 or 5 hearings to really formulate a very solid maritime law. Mm. Next hearing, we will be comparing our proposals with the existing maritime laws of ASEAN countries, including the claimants of the South China Sea.
Mm. And it's not as if we're going to start from zero, right, Senator? Because you have studies out there, you have experts. Mm-hmm. It's just a matter of collating.
Really zero, because we have a baseline law.
Correct.
We have an existing baseline law. From the baseline law, we proceed outwards to the sea. And this is not just going to be your West Philippine Sea maritime law. The other side of the Pacific would also be involved. The Benham Rise would also be involved.
All right. Just yesterday, I was able to speak with Commodore Coloma, and we talked about the recent swarming of Chinese fishing vessels. So if we had this map in existence, how could have that helped the situation, Senator?
Legally, it would help, but there's a big difference between actual prevention from the legal basis on what they're doing is illegal. So, but then again, as I've said, we need this law. We need this law to fortify our claims. We need this law because this will transform international law, the law of the sea, into a domestic law.
Mm. And also, Senator, a way to educate the younger generation about what is ours.
Definitely. Definitely, to educate the younger generations on the extent, breadth of our claims. We have to claim. It is an entitlement provided for us by UNCLOS, but we have to claim it. So younger generations would know the extent of where our waters would lie, plus it would probably educate all of us that perhaps 40% of our fisheries would come from the West Philippine Sea. And billions of liters probably would be emanating from the West Philippine Sea as well for our energy needs, including natural gas. It is high time that we highlight this, because a lot of people have been saying malayo sa sikmura. Hindi po. It has something to do with food security and energy security as well.
You said a while ago that it was one of the criticisms made by China that we do not have this kind of a map. But now that you're working on it, and once it is in existence, do you think it's going to serve as enough of a deterrent to China, who claims whatever it is that she wants to claim? Go ahead.
Definitely, we will be sending a copy to the UNCLOS Secretariat as well as the United Nations. So for their recognition as well. But again, the other countries supporting us would also be supporting our claims based on our new maritime zone law. And the maritime zone law would have other progenies as well. We will have a new archipelagic sea lane where vessels should pass, even with freedom of navigation being accepted. And as we learned yesterday, it would also include an air route lane. So these are new. So where should vessels pass? And then we will be, all of this would also include apex issues such as preserving biodiversity in the area, preserving our natural resources, among others.
Now, this should have been the natural progression from the baseline law, but Senator, let's learn from history. Why wasn't it done?
I don't know. I was not yet a member of the Senate then. It should have been done. I think it should have been done as early 2000 or late 90s.
And now that you're doing
We're doing it. I think it's about time that we have it. And I, from the inaugural hearing yesterday, we have several senators who attended, even on a late Thursday afternoon, because I also came from another meeting. Plus, we have several resource persons coming from other jurisdictions. We have one from Australia, we have one from Princeton University, among others. So this is going to be not just a purely legal document, but buttressed by academic grounding.
All right. As you mentioned at the top of this interview, Senator, I'm talking to you as you've just come down from the mountains of Davao del Norte. You were with the Manobo tribe, and I gather that they have some issues. What are these issues, Senator?
I distributed some notebooks to the children of the tribal community members, and then we finished a groundbreaking ceremony of a biomass facility, which I initiated because hanggang ngayon wala pang kuryente ron. These are our IT. So biomass probably would help them energize the entire community as well as make them more productive. And I think these are the reality on the ground is that most of them are isolated. I just realized having breakfast with them that they could afford rice meal once a week.
Wow.
Once a week. And yet we're talking about increases of prices of rice.
Yeah.
And they served me rice this morning. It was an important affair for them because that's all that they could afford once a week.
That's heartbreaking, Senator.
Yes, yes. I could still... No, probably what they served me would have been served to other members of the tribes as well, but I just realized that even if the staple food of Filipinos would be rice, some IPs or tribal communities would be having rice just once a week. I could not believe that, Carmina.
Yeah, so let's talk about that issue now, Senator. I mean, there's a price gap that's still holding, but then again, beyond that, there's a lot of things that need to be done in the agriculture sector.
Yeah,
what can be done at this point to help our farmers, help our consumers? Kasi paikot-ikot na lang po eh, Senator.
Yes, it's one. Legally, we will be having a new anti-smuggling law next week coming out from the office of Senator Cynthia Villar. But I'll be proposing an amendment that there be an agricultural anti-agricultural smuggling court designating a division of the Court of Tax Appeals to handle this, updating the provisions therein. For instance, today, it would appear that there's a conflict between the Regional Trial Court and the Court of Tax Appeals as to the amount, as to the jurisdictional value, whether it is 1 million below or 1 million above. And this has led to an impasse. A lot of the smugglers are yet to be convicted because of this jurisdictional issue. So we're going to rectify this next week, plus perhaps rein in some of the discretion of the Europe Customs insofar as prosecuting cases, because most of the cases dismissed were apparently because of lack of documents coming from the Bureau of Customs. Courts would not accept Xerox copies of documents. So this has to be changed. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, wala namang makukulong kahit mga smuggler ng bigas or other agricultural products as well. Kawawa talaga yung mga kababayan.
Baka naman, Senator, yun talaga yung pakay. Because...
walang. Your guess is as...
Because we were also talking to Senator Cynthia Villar, and she actually mentioned that as well. Take away the powers of the Bureau of Customs to file the charges, because most often than not, the allegations is that they're in on it.
The evidence cannot be sustained in court, so wala nangyayari.
Mm-mm.
And yet, balik ako dun sa unang sinabi ko sa inyo kanina, into community where they eat rice once a week.
Imagine that. This has got to stop. We look forward to talking to you again. Senator Francis Tolentino there joining us on the line.
Thank you
again.
Your time.
Take care.
Thank you.